looking at the song, one bourbon, one scotch, and one beer. I believe it was first recorded in 53, then recorded by John Lee Hooker in 66, and then you owned it in 77, right? But with that, what made you want to record that song?
Well, first of all, I knew it was a hit. Mm-hmm. I said, if Tom Waits had done it, it would have been a hit. If Jay Giles did, the song is bigger than me. I said, Someone's going to grab the song. But what really got to me about that tune, the first time I went to see John Lee Hooker was in 1971. At that time, there was this big blues revival going on, and people looked at the blues like it was, like, go see Muddy Waters or Fred McDowell or Mississippi John, and it was like a temple. No one even breathed a word. It was like this, it was on a whole different level of people, you know, worshiping this art form, and they would, you never even hear people talking or anything. When Hooker played, I went to see him and do two sets, and people were dancing all over the dance floor. And I thought, dancing to the blues? It's not done. It's not done. And I kept watching it, and almost all the people dancing were women. Mm. And the song all the women got up and danced to was One Bourbon, One Scotch, and One Beer. And he did it in both sets. And I said, if I ever get a band together, that's the first song I'm going after. Hooker knew what he was doing. See, he's got that rhythm that gets into people. There's that rhythm. I bet half those ladies never even heard that song before. But something got them up there. Yeah. And to Hooker, this was just business as usual for him. Because that's what he's all about. So that's what inspired me to do it. I said, if you do that, let's see how I do with it. Let's see if we can, you know, mm-hmm. what reaction we get from this. So, well, they're still playing it on the radio, so.
Yeah, from 77.
That's a long time.
It's incredible.
Yeah.